Tom Monahan, your Ward 2 city councilor. We're going to have a few different topics tonight. We're going to talk a little bit about the diversity in the city, how to get everybody involved from the different communities, what they're looking for, what their needs are. We're going to talk about the plan for downtown with the city planner. We have a really exciting plan for downtown. Things are happening. We just received grant money.
Yes.
For the incubator.
Study for the incubator.
Yep.
Restaurant incubator.
Downtown. Hopefully, Mayor Carpenter will be here. State Representative Brady. She'll be up in a second. Our new Ward 2 school committee woman is Lisa Plant. She'll say a few words in a minute right there, is Lisa. And I'm going to have the new elected officials come up and say a word. Just elected as a councilor at large is Wynn Farwell. Come on up, Wynn. Mayor Farwell. Sorry. How do we say that? Mayor slash councilor?
No. Wynn is better. I'm going to be very brief. It's a real honor to be here with Tom. It's a special honor to serve all of you as a councilor at large. From what I've seen during the campaign and the times we've been together, I think you're going to see a real team effort with the 11 councilors and with other city officials, the mayor, Mr. May from planning. So I really foresee some very good things happening in the next couple of years. And it does take a team effort. We may be in Ward 2, but as I just said to Councilor Azak, the issues are kind of the same all across the city. So to the extent that we network with each other, and we learn from each other, and we listen to the concerns in Ward 2 and the concerns in other wards, I think we'll have a very good approach to what needs to be done. So again, it's an honor to be here. I can't thank you enough for sponsoring this and inviting us to come in. So
thank you. Thanks, Wynn. Okay, and now we have the new Ward 6 city councilor, Jack Lally. Come on up, Jack.
Hi, I'm Jack Lally. I was just elected to represent Ward 6, as Tom said. I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to affecting how the city operates, making a difference. And that's all I have for right now.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Ann Beauregard is a new Ward 5 city council, but she's not here tonight. She's going to make it. Let's bring up Lisa Plant, our new Ward 2 school committee woman, right here. Andy Robinson's place, and she's about the same height, but she's a lot better looking.
I think the microphone's still too high.
Yeah, exactly.
Put that up in the corner. I've never had to adjust a microphone. I better get used to this. Well, I am the new school committee rep. We've only had one meeting so far, just an organizational meeting. So we really just got put on our subcommittees at this point. The only other things that you've been talking about, obviously we're discussing a charter school possibly coming to Brockton. Talking about state funding, but like I said, all we've had is one meeting. It was organizational, so we really haven't discussed anything else other than that right now. I just want to let everybody know that you can reach any of your school committee reps on the Brockton Public Schools page. They've been updated, so everybody's phone numbers are on there now, everybody's email addresses, so whatever ward you're from, you can find your school committee rep. You can contact them, and I look forward to working with everybody in our ward, everybody at the city, and I would love to hear from students as well. So please encourage your students to reach out as well. My daughter's at the high school. I told her if she knows any kids that are having concerns, tell them to call me or tell them to Facebook me, whatever they want to do. So
is your phone number on Facebook, or do you have your cards with you?
Cards?
You get any cards?
You
get any cards? Okay.
I have a Facebook page, Lisa Plant, Ward 2 School Committee, that I thought maybe even the students, that might be better if they want to just go on there and message me, not on my personal Facebook page really, but to use that one, the school committee page, and my email address and my phone number are both on the Brockton Public Schools site.
Okay. Right,
so,
okay.
Okay?
All right, thanks a lot, Lisa. Okay, and let's put that way bad though. I want to recognize a couple of candidates for state rep in the 9th Plymouth District. We have Shirley Azak right here. And Jerry Cassidy right over there. Usually it takes a long time. Senator Brady, so I'll let him come up now, get him out of the way. We've got to put the timer on him. State rep, newly elected state rep, Mike Brady.
Thank you, Council. I'll try to be brief. I know there's a lot of people here today. I want to congratulate all the newly elected officials that are here and welcome. I did serve at one point when I was a lot younger and thinner and less gray hairs on the school committee in Brockton, so welcome to our new school committee members as well as the city councils. We're dealing right now at the state level with the upcoming budget. The governor's going to be coming out with it this month, and then it goes to the House, which I was a former member for 7.5 years, and then it goes over to the Senate side. And then 99% of the time, there's always differences between the House version, the governor's version, and the Senate version, so then it goes to a conference committee. And then it comes back to us for a vote, and we work with the Ways and Means Committees in both the House and the Senate to try to work to get funding for our districts, and especially Brockton, which depends greatly on state funding. We wouldn't survive without state funding, especially our school system in Brockton, which is Chapter 70 money from the state, and our roads, which are in deplorable condition. That requires a lot of funding from the state as well with Chapter 90 money. Some important legislation that the House just passed this week, and the Senate passed it back in October, is in regards to the opioid addiction crisis, which is affecting not just cities like Brockton, but very affluent communities west and Dover and all across the Commonwealth. And we've passed some legislation last semester on this, and we did a supplemental budget on this, but it still is not enough. The insurance companies are pushing back, only allowing 14 days in a rehab facility, which is by far not enough. So we're fighting to expand upon that, and I filed a bill on that. But the recidivism that's affecting our community is affecting every family out there, no matter where you're from and what walks of life, and we need to do more on this. So some things the House passed the other day, which the Senate had passed earlier in similarities, is ends a practice of sending women to a civilly committed, some of the women who had addiction problems were sent to MCI Framingham, which is not the place for women who have an addiction problem. They should be in another facility. So we're ending the practice of that because they were put in with hard murderers and everybody else. Ensure civil liability protection for individuals who administer Narcan. And I know the City of Brockton, thanks to the efforts of the City Council, the Mayor's Office, and the School Committee, we are administering Narcan with the firefighters and police officers in Brockton, but some other communities were not doing so. And updates to training guidelines for all practitioners who prescribe controlled substances. And establishes a Massachusetts Council on Substance Abuse Disorder Prevention and all of that. So we are working to address a serious issue that's affecting too many families out there. And as I mentioned, the budget we'll be dealing with shortly. Anybody who wants to contact my office in regards to any issues or concerns with the budget, of course, we never have enough money from the Commonwealth. When I was on the City Council many years ago, we had a great economy. We were able to build 5 elementary schools with 90% reimbursement from the state. We built a council and aging facility named after Tommy Kennedy's mother, the Mary Kennedy Senior Center. That was funded through lottery money when Shane O'Brien was a treasurer. We get an expanse of our downtown library, which was fantastic with a lot of efforts from a lot of people in this community that Governor Cellucci had vetoed the funding. We lobbied the legislator at the time with a lot of efforts from some of the members of the people in this room. And things were going good. And then I got into the State House and all of a sudden the economy crashed more or less. So, yes, that. but things started to get better. And out in the private sector, there's more job creation going on. Property values have started to go back up. Things are looking good. But our governor just came out with a situation that there's a deficit, and he's proposing some cuts. So we're looking for any funding means to keep the simple services that we depend on from the state, you know, schools, roads, public safety. I served as a vice chairman of public safety in the House side, and we were always fighting to get the Shannon Grant back in place for cities like Brockton because it's so important to help our police department with all the work for preventive medicine to keep these kids off the streets so they don't fall through the cracks. So we're going to be working on that, but please don't hesitate to contact my office with anything needed. And if you want to just come and say hello in the State House, you're more than welcome as well. So thank
anything
you.
New on the downtown colleges?
I did speak. Secretary of Economic Development was at a chamber event at Stonehill College this week, and I bugged his ear again about trying to get the funding back in place because the governor did put on hold our college collaboration for downtown, which the state owns the old Ganley building, as well as the Allied Health Center over at the Massasoit College, which was going to be where the Christo's restaurant used to be. And it was already approved under the Patrick administration, but as we all know, until the shovel's in the ground, it doesn't mean anything. It's just on paper. And I understand that the new governor wants to keep an eye on all spending and so forth, but this is something we worked on for many, many years. There's a need. The nursing program alone at Massasoit has a waiting list of a couple hundred students with perfect grade point averages. Healthcare is where the jobs are. And for our downtown, you know, since the high school got built up, the West Side, which was a beautiful high school in 1970, and the malls got built, we've lost a lot of the foot traffic in downtown. And I remember in my days at Northeastern University, some of the most difficult neighborhoods where Wentworth and Northeastern, where they expanded, now you got a coffee shop, you've got a dry cleaners, it helps the private sector as well. This collaboration is so important for Brockton. But again, unfortunately, it's in the governor's hands, and he put that on hold along with community college expansion in Framingham and down the Cape. So we're going to continue to work with the administration of finance to try to get this back on the rolls. And our DA's office as well, because they're in need of a new facility. And I've been meeting with the administration on that, because our DA's office has been outdated since Bill O'Malley was the DA, never mind Tim Cruz. So we're working to have another facility and to keep the DA's office downtown, which is so important. And if that goes through, they're looking to maybe house some state troopers in downtown to help with our local Brockton Police Department. Sometimes with drug cases, they can't store the stuff in the local DA's office or wherever here, because they have nowhere to store the stuff in a safe location. So they're bringing it out of town, and it takes time, and it hampers everything in their process of when they go to court and trying to get these prosecutions upheld. So again, thank you, and I'm going to give it back to our Ward 2 counselor, who's doing a great job, Tom Monahan.
Thank you, Senator. Okay, now I'm going to bring up Officer Bill Haley. He's in charge of Neighborhood Watch. He's going to be here all night in case anybody has any specific issues, but he's going to give you his contact information.
Thanks, Counselor. Hello, everyone. Again, because of the anonymity of my program, and we're on cable, if people had certain questions for me, it would be uncomfortable for me to answer them. So I told the council this is going to go on for a while. I'll be here the duration. If you want to meet me up there or outside there by the lounge area to answer any concerns you may have. Some are uncomfortable talking in this type of environment, especially with the camera going. So for the people in TV world and everybody here uses the computer now, and it's this simple. Brockton Police Department website, Neighborhood Watch, click down, tip line, my personal information, my email address. Use any of those venues or avenues, and I will get back to you. What's especially important today, when you click onto that website, is our tip line. If you read the paper on a weekly basis, you'll see that many of the bad guys are caught. The drug guys and the gun guys. One of the things I can't talk about tonight is what happened a couple of nights ago regarding the shootings up on Wilson in Pine Grove. It's actively being worked on. But we need that. Matter of fact, there's an emergency meeting up there Tuesday that I'll be attending to put the people at Pine Grove at ease, to let them know what's going on. So what they hear from me isn't what they're reading in the paper. And I'll give as much information as I can without compromising the investigation. But what we need, and again, it's on my links, tips, especially, and I'll address this with the people up there, and I already have with management, they have the information, especially with people up there. People have seen things and know things. You send that tip, it's strictly anonymous. Believe me when I tell you, I don't know who you are. And even if I did, I couldn't reveal the source even to a court, even to a judge. That's what this program's about. Send the tips in, I print them, they go to the chief of police, the chief of police delegates the tips. Many of who we catch is because of that tip line. The mayor just walked in, he knows it, he's a huge advocate of it, he knows how it works, he's with the chief all the time. A lot of good information, I'll never know who it was. Send that tip, it helps, and at the end of the day, like I says, every single week if you read the paper, we're catching the drug guys, we're catching the gun guys. The problem is with the drug issue, which is bad across the country, the drug issue, brings out the gun guys, because the gun guys are doing the dealing. And that's a problem we have. And most of those that are coming to the city to purchase narcotics live outside of the city. In fact, fire department, police department have taken those stats. They're from outside of the city. But the dealing is always big cities. Dealing's not going on to this extent in the town of Canton, the town of Westwood, Wellesley. They're able to control it because population, I mean, it's cities that bring in the issues that we have with the dealing. So tips, I'll never know about it. Submit them, they get printed, and we pick up a lot of bad people because of it. And I'll be here the duration. Oh, and for those of you that don't have a computer or don't use it, my number's 508-897-5373. Direct contact to my office line, and I'll get back to you.
You didn't have a calendar?
No, because everybody in here is using a computer but two.
Okay.
That's website. That's simple.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir. Okay, we'd like to also recognize the last president of the city council, Dennis Ioneary. Councilor Ioneary from Ward 5. Over there, stuffing his face again. What else is those?
Okay.
Ward 3. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. It's one of those nights, yeah. Well, it's upside down. Whatever. The mayor's here, so I'm going to let him. His part coming that we're going to start with now. Moises Rodriguez, Councilor Rodriguez at large, has been a great addition to the city council. He's going to speak tonight about getting everybody in the city involved in the city, in government, how they can get involved. The face of the city has really started changing. We have a lot of non-English speaking residents now, all across the Ward 2 especially, but across the whole city, and we're trying to get everybody involved, all the different communities. I have people from them here tonight to speak on what their needs are, what they need from the city to help them, and what we need from them to help themselves. So we want to get them all involved, and tonight I'm going to have, I'll have Moises go last and the mayor after him. But first off, we're going to start off with Melissa Rodriguez. Is that your name?
Hello, good evening. My name is Melissa Rodriguez, and I want to thank Tom Monahan for allowing me to speak about my organization. The name of my organization is LULAC, which stands for the League of United Latin Americans, and it was created in 1929, which makes it the oldest Latin American organization in the whole United States, including Puerto Rico. And what LULAC does, they do put together a lot of events and fundraisers to unite our Latin community and also help our students to continue their education. We also raise money for people with financial needs and health issues. So I really love this organization. They're very united, they're very involved, and I love it so much that I decided to open a council here in Brockton with my husband, Jose Rodriguez. So this year we're gonna be putting together a lot of events and fundraisers so we can have the same benefits come here to the city of Champion just like they do in Boston. So we're really excited, and I need your support. And if you wanna be involved, or if you have any questions, you wanna know more about my organization, you can either ask me or my husband, Jose Rodriguez. Okay,
that's it. Thank you, Melissa. This next gentleman, I really don't like that much because he's too good looking. He's a sharp dresser. Every time I see him on Facebook, he just looks too good. It's Adius Pierre. Come on up, Adius.
Good evening. Good evening. Tom, thank you so much. First, I apologize, my voice is not too good. I have a bad cold. But because I said yes to Tom, and I try to keep my word. I'm a man of my word. So please allow me to share a few words with you tonight. I'm going to be very, very brief. And I would like to say hello to Mayor Bill Carpenter, Senator Brady, all the officials. Good evening. My name is Adjis Pierre, and I went for city council at large. I didn't make it, but I don't give up. I don't think I have to be elected to serve my city. It doesn't happen this time. I'm sure it's gonna happen when the time is right. Tonight I'm here to tell you as a resident of Ward 2, I have a good relationship with Tom, and please help me congratulate them for winning the election again. We always talk, and when he asked me to come tonight, I said, yes, I'm going to share a few words with you, what we need in the city, because we are one in the city. It takes my effort, your effort, to make the city great again. What I mean by that? It's winter time. Snow is already there. Let's clean up the sidewalk for people to work. So many kids in the city don't have transportation to go to school. So they need the sidewalk to work. Because as a school community member here, you know if a child doesn't live within 3 miles, that child doesn't have any transportation. But you can help that child by keep your sidewalk clean. When it's springtime or summertime, please cut your grass. Don't let someone to call you to do it. This is your home, that represents your face. Everywhere you go, your home represents you. If you don't clean it, who's gonna do it for you? And guess what, if you don't clean it, that's gonna attract bad things to happen. The third one is neighborhood watch. You see something, say something. Too many shooting in the city. I left my house a few months ago on Saturday. My wife called me and said to come back. When I came back, it was a driving shooting by. When BCI and Walton Police came, they collected 7 shell cases right in front of my driveway. It was this week. A gentleman get shot at Pine Estate. We cannot say one place at the one time because he was at home in his bedroom. So we need to make a stop to that. We need to watch and look out for each other. That's why I'm here tonight, to let you know we're gonna work together to change the city and to claim the city of champion again. We can do it. This is Dr. Martin Luther King month. I would like to wish you all happy Martin Luther King Day. And he said, often men hate each other because they fear each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they don't communicate with each other. They don't communicate with each other because they're separate. Tonight, I'm gonna ask you together to build a bridge to reconnect again to make Brockton the city of champions. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you, Edis. And now from the NAACP, you're still involved with them, aren't you? My classmate, actually, we both had hair in 1974 when we graduated. Miles Jackson.
Thank you, Tom. And thanks for inviting me. My name is Miles Jackson. I'm from Ward 6, and I got to meet our new Ward 6 counselor, John Lally. I look forward to working with him. And I'm a Brockton resident. I've been here for 47 years, since 1968. I came out here in the sixth grade after King got killed. My parents moved us out here to Brockton. And that was kind of a start of when some city folks started coming out to the suburbs of places like Brockton. And I was one of them. And I thought I died and went to heaven coming from the city out here to beautiful Brockton. And Brockton had a downtown when I was here. And like I think Tom said, or one of the gentlemen said, once Westgate came, just like all across the country, our downtown kind of declined a little bit. But people like Tom and our mayor, they take pride in Brockton and along with everybody else and Brother Brady, and they're trying to bring it back. Along with myself, I'm involved with the NAACP. I'm also involved with BIC. And I think that organizations like that, we need to join, because the whole thing is all about communication. And the young lady that just stood up here talked the League of Latin Americans. You know, and I always wondered, you know, I'd never heard too much about our Latin brothers, like our Puerto Rican brothers and so on. But League of Latin Americans, that's coming into Brockton, and that's something else we want to get involved with. Because, you know, when I grew up, basically, it was mostly our Caucasian brothers here in Brockton. And any people of color were all considered Afro-American or whatever. I had some Puerto Rican brothers. I had some, they called themselves at the time Portuguese, but they come to find out as we get into the millennium, they were actually Cape Verdean. But, you know, as we know, the history of Cape Verde, Portuguese settlers came down the African coast and discovered the beautiful country of Cape Verde. And as we know about Haitian community, it's the second country in the Western Hemisphere to gain its independence here in the Western Hemisphere was Haiti, which they gained its anti-slavery and anti-colonial freedom here in right down from us, from the United States. So we have a lot in common. As you know, I said, our cultural landscape has changed the past 35, 40 years. I went to Brockton High, like I said, then I went to UMass, then I went in the Air Force. When I got back here in 82, I noticed there was a change. You could tell, like, Temple Beth Emunah just closed down because our Jewish friends, basically, not all of them, but some of them have left, and there just wasn't enough folks to keep that place up. So Brockton is changing. A lot of our Catholic churches have changed. I remember growing up playing in the Brockton Y League. You had all the teams, Catholic teams represented, Sacred Heart, St. Coleman's. Some of y'all recognize them names, but they're no more. But I look forward to working with our Haitian community, our Cape Verdean community, our Latino community here, and also our Caucasian community.
Thanks, buddy. He's a smack of use of being in basketball.
Yeah, that's it. But just talking about Mayor Carpenter, this guy's really focused on turning Brockton around with his communication in City Hall. I walked into City Hall when he took over last year, and I noticed there was a change. I saw people that looked like me in there, and I think that's a good start right there. He's excellent on communicating through our electronic media. Something that's really great about what he's done. And he's also brought on some Haitian and Cape Verdean police officers, which we definitely need here in Brockton for domestic issues. Because if the cops don't know if a domestic issue and they come up to the house and they don't know the language or understand, then that even adds to the problem. So I commend him on that. And again, it's all about communication with us here. You can look around and see there's all kinds of colors and shapes and sizes. And we all have to work together. And I think most of us want to work together. And all we have to do is change the minds of those that are stereotyping us. You know, and I'm talking about Haitian stereotyping Cape Verdeans, African-American stereotyping Haitians, and so on. And we just need all to communicate together. And I think we could, you know, it's a slow process, but it can happen. It can happen. So again, Tom, I want to thank you for letting me get up here and say a few words. And God bless everybody. We'll see you later. Yes.
Miles. Excuse me. I forgot to mention. Do you want to mention about the prostate cancer awareness on Saturdays right after the breakfast?
Exactly. Right after the MLK breakfast that the NAACP is having this Saturday at 9, we're having a prostate awareness seminar. It won't be long, right after the breakfast. So if any of you guys are going to the breakfast, especially the men, and especially men of color, there's a big problem in inner cities and cities with men of color and prostate cancer. That's one of the big killers of us. So just pass the word on. It's all about communication right there. Mike communicated, you know, and I'm going to be there, but that's a very important issue. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you, Miles. Miles, can I have my agenda back?
Oh, yeah.
You beat him in the championship game, and he's still trying to get back.
St. Patrick's.
That's right. Yeah. All right. What Miles says is very true, and really did a good job, Adius, too. Thank you. Let's bring up now Councilor at Large Moises Rodriguez. He wanted pizza first, please, man.
No, I wanted a pizza. Okay. Well, first of all, good evening. Bonsoir. Buenas noches. Boa noite. Então, espera-me que ali se lhe é que são as únicas reuniões ali que nós está bem. Conheço que a minha reunião só que problema está, mas apenas participa para o governo de Cidade está funciona, ou que tudo a regência está funciona, né? Conheço espera só que o lume está na casa, conheço para galo. Nos evita para o lume que assim. Well, basically, what I said to the two tables of Cape Verdeans sitting up here is that they shouldn't only come to meetings when the place is on fire. I know that we have some problems with some taxes in the community that has some people up in arms about, that we should only come when the fire is burning us. We should also come when the fires are burning everybody, because that's the only way that this city is going to become the city that it should be. Brockton, as I said, throughout the campaign, throughout my involvement in the city, has always been a city of immigrants. When you look around, it started out with the folks coming from when the pilgrims came. It continued on with the earlier Europeans that came, the Italians, the Irish, the Germans, etc., etc. And it continues today with Cape Verdeans, Haitians, Hispanics, and some of the other folks that come. So the demographics of this city hasn't really changed all that much. Yeah, the where people are from might have changed, but as far as the demographics, it hasn't really changed all that much. But what has changed, however, and I'm going to say this as a minority in this city, is the lack of participation from the minority community within city government. We often sit back and wait until we have issues to go out and protest those issues. We're not very proactive in terms of coming out and getting involved in city government. I've been involved for the last couple years, and this is an open government. But it's only open government when everybody participates. You can sit here and blame the mayor, blame the city councilors, blame the school committee folks for the issues in the community. But Brockton's problems can only be solved by Brocktonians. Brocktonians that came from Ireland, from Italy, from Cape Verde, from Haiti, from Senegal, from Puerto Rico, from the Dominican Republic, from wherever you came from, that's the only way that the problems of the city are going to resolve. But for that to happen, we need everybody to buy into that program. We can't just sit back and wait for city government to resolve the problems. I said it throughout the campaign that the issue of violence in this community is a simple issue. It's not an issue, because when we talk about throwing more police on the streets, throwing more firepower in the streets, we're almost making it sound like the men and women in the police department are not doing a good job, when in fact that's not the case. They do a great job. They do a great job in fighting crime once it happens. But what we need to do is prevent crime from happening. And the only way that crime can stop is by preventing from happening in the first place. And the only way that that's going to stop is when the community comes together and decides that enough is enough, let's stop with this nonsense. You know, it's not the police. The police, unless you find 100,000 police officers and give every single resident of this city a police officer in their homes, we're never going to have enough police officers to go around. But what we do have is 100,000 people that, once we decide as a unit, as one big community, that enough is enough to stop the issues of violence in our community, that will stop. So the reason why I'm saying all of this is that I think I'm the only multilingual in the council.
Actually, no. I correct that.
All right,
so
you do another.
Does Pig Latin count?
I said Marty.
I am. Okay, so
being one of two multilinguals in the council and the one that can actually speak to some of the folks in this room, the reason why I'm doing this and saying this is because I'm leaving it up here and to you folks that we need your help. We need your help to make the city a better city. We need your help to come along and help us make the city deserves to be a city for a lot of people to come together and enjoy with peace and tranquility as they deserve. Yes?
Okay. Non sta papiera criolla. I custali non cresce be come ogni odor se be tax, ma lo conteneva un'informazione ma tax stava per subire. Portanto, noi praticamente oggi abbiamo una subita molto grande.
Hoje do Castelli, she's asking a question about taxes. Hoje do Castelli, diretamente por papia para Morik Tax subir. Tem mais evento marcado para quarta-feira, ali naquela escola, ali sim. O Gens de Tax, que também explica exatamente para Morik Tax subir de forma que ele subir. Hoje, o que a Cruz está a fazer é pedir alguém para envolver com nós, para ajudar a melhorar a cidade. O problema de tax é discutido meses e meses antes do próprio dia que eu recebi ele. Como é, e a primeira coisa que está fazendo, aquele processo está começando a ser errado, num de que esta começa com aquela apresentação, esta apresentada na City Council, às vezes 12 vezes, e aquele coisa é gravado na televisão, que as reuniões do City Council é aberto para todo alguém vai. Ou que o bem recebe tax dia na casa, já estão cozinha tarde com o bem fazer algumas modificações. O importante é participar naquele processo que os estatamentos seguintes também para participar nele. E digo assim para frente, uma coisa que eu também fazer pessoalmente é bem informar a comunidade o que esse processo está acontecendo para as pessoas começarem a se envolver naquelas coisas.
Para morrer. Eu vou para maquiar, de voto, essa tem engana, tem voto, para levar para esse, para terra, para os assuntos. Vamos para mais que assumir nossas carências. Vamos que está para mim, Zé.
O que alguém acaba para pior, eu também traduzi isso de forma. Volta
30, 300, medindo.
Basically, what the young lady prior to the other young lady said was the fact that a lot of them found out that their taxes were increased as here's your bill, your taxes increased. That there was no process that they needed to know of, or there was no process of explaining that that process was going to take place. And what I basically said is that that process is a long process. It starts early on with the assessors assessing, the assessors presenting it to the city council. There's debates that take place in the city council, and then it gets voted in before it becomes law, so that people need to get involved in the process off, you know, right off the bat so that you have a voice in what happens within the text.
It's a thousand. Thousands is a higher.
So I know that the mayor is going to come out after me. We need to remember... We need to remember that we are your legislative body, and our process is basically to take the information that the executive branch hands us, and we do the deliberation, and we make those things happen in terms of approving or disapproving. We often can't do much in terms of dictating where the cuts go. All we can do is cut what needs to be cut, and that's what needs to be understood as well. All right, I'm just going to leave it here, and hopefully you understood what I said, and we'll have a lot more participation from my
community. Thank you, Mayor. And just, I might as well say it now, Councilor Large, Wynn Fowler, and myself are going to sponsor a tax abatement workshop on the 20th at 6 o'clock at the Arnone School, along with Bernie Hassan, who's helping us out. We might have a few others coming in to help us out on that. We're going to have some translators there, I think, Adius Pierre. Fred, I think Fred Fontaine, you're going to be there? The 20th, I mean. Okay. Anyway, we'll have some translators to help people out, explain the process of how it works, and that's going to be on January 20th, 6 o'clock at the theater at the Arnone School. All right, and now let's bring up our mayor, Mayor Bill Carpenter.
Let's see if I can take it out all together if I can.
There we go. Can everyone hear me okay? Well, I guess we have a number of topics you'd probably like to hear me comment on tonight, so I'll try to touch on the big ones, and then if I leave something out, please be sure to let me know, and I'll do the best I can to answer the question. I think I'll start with gun violence, because despite other things we may be unhappy about, in my mind, violent crime is absolutely the number one challenge facing the city. And certainly earlier this week, we had a bad week when a 17-year-old young man standing in his kitchen was struck by a stray bullet. And that scares the daylights out of everybody, including myself. And I sometimes get in trouble for using the phrase urban terrorist because people misunderstand it. But I think that if people are living in a neighborhood that's full of mostly good people, and there are a few people that are in that neighborhood carrying guns, selling drugs, and firing the gun off with reckless disregard for anyone else's safety, they are terrorizing the rest of the people who live in that neighborhood. People should not be afraid of their neighborhood. So I agree with a lot of what Councilor Rodriguez said. The real solutions are long-term solutions. And the real solutions do involve the community. Crime is not just a police issue, it's not just a mayor issue, it's a community issue. And as a community, we have to decide that enough is enough. I don't know how you feel, but I've already decided enough is enough. But we need everybody's help to get this thing turned around. A quick update on the young man, Zach Seidlinger. He is recovering at the hospital. He's out of intensive care. He's in a regular room. He had some of his friends visit him today for the first time. And he's going to make a complete recovery, but he's certainly going through a difficult time right now as he makes that complete recovery. And I've tried to let he and his mom know that they have the support of the people in this city. And I think our challenge is to make sure that something like that never happens again. That's our challenge. In terms of some specifics, and again, with some of Councilor Rodriguez's comments, we do need more help from the community. We need information from the community. One thing I've learned in almost every one of these incidents that involves gunfire, the victim never, ever cooperates with the police or the investigators. I can't remember the last time that a victim of a shooting gave us any useful information whatsoever. And I mention that because I just think for people that have never seen or been involved in something like this and think, gee, if someone assaulted me or if I was a witness to crime, I would certainly tell the police everything I knew. Well, in this culture in which, you know, some people are living in this city right now, there's just no information coming. So we have to develop other sources of information. That's why we've tried, as Officer Healy said earlier, to implement a number of different ways that people can anonymously send information to the police department. If you go on the city website, there's a nice, easy to find icon to give anonymous tips to the police. If you go on the police department website, it's also there. There's also an app that you can download to a smartphone that, once again, will send information anonymously to the police. It cannot be traced back. We're trying to put mechanisms in place to make it easier for people who may be afraid of retribution but are tired of living next door to a drug dealer and would like to send us some information. So it is really important, and the information we receive is investigated every single time. Getting back to the gun violence of the past week or so, I did yesterday morning have a chance to meet with the U.S. attorney while she was here in the city and had a one-on-one meeting with her. And she reaffirmed the cooperation that we're getting from the federal law enforcement agencies. The FBI and the ATF are here in the city every day. The DEA is here. And right now there are several long-term investigations going on that we would not have the resources to do ourselves if it were not for the feds coming in with their resources and being willing to incur a lot of the expenses. And I'm assured that, you know, in the not too distant future, you'll see the results of some of those long-term investigations coming to fruition with some major arrests. And, you know, you're right, counsel, this is not something we just arrest ourselves out of. However, when I talk to a constituent like Adias, who has shell casings in the street outside of his house, when I talk to a homeowner like that, I can tell you that they have no interest in my philosophy on long-term solutions to reducing crime. They want to know what the hell we're going to do about it today to make them safe in their house and their neighborhood. And that's why we have to take short-term steps also to proactively go after the people, to identify the people, and go after the people who are carrying illegal crime guns, who are firing these guns, and who are selling drugs to our kids. And that's what we're doing, and we're doing it very aggressively. I also met, and the U.S. Attorney, by the way, committed to continue to send resources here. We also reached out to the state police this week, as we have in the past, and we received a commitment for a substantial influx of state police troopers. The entire community action team will be here in the city for the foreseeable future. That's an average of usually 5 or 6 cruisers per night here in the city, as compared to the 1 or 2 that might typically be here. And that will help. They're primarily in high visibility places, running traffic, doing car stops, and it will have a suppression effect. And then I also met with the district attorney earlier today in my office, and we talked about some of the active and ongoing investigations, particularly those around guns and drugs. And it's very difficult to separate guns and drugs anymore. It's all together. The drug dealers are carrying guns. People that are gang involved are in the drug distribution business. The gangs are selling drugs. The drug dealers are carrying guns. The issue of illegal crime guns cuts through all of that. It's not easily separated. But we are expending the resources to identify and go after those people. I will tell you, and I have to be careful what I say, but from speaking with the DA and the police chief and the U.S. attorney, in this recent flare-up of gun violence over the last week, or maybe slightly more than a week now, there are common denominators amongst the various incidents. This is not just widespread, random gun violence. There's common denominators that connect these events. And there are very active investigations going on. The night that the young man was shot, there was another incident later that night in which the police recovered 3 guns, and those guns are going through ballistics testings right now, and we think at least 1 or 2 of them will be able to be connected to shell casings and other incidents. There are common denominators and common threads that connect these incidents, and there are very active investigations of people of interest right now, however, not at the point that they're ready to make an arrest yet. There are some real challenges. We can't, the Brockton police, even with all the multi-agency cooperation with the county, the state, the feds, we need some help in some areas too. The misuse of rental cars is a huge obstacle to right now to the investigations. In almost every single one of these instances, there is a rental car or rental cars involved. And people are using rental cars, swapping them out every week or two. It allows them to evade police when they can, if they're being stopped. Because in a rental car, if they can just get out of sight for 30 seconds, they stop the car, jump out and run, leave the car behind. They can't be connected to the car. And within an hour or two, that car will be reported stolen. And the car is never rented by the people using it. It's rented by a girlfriend, a sister, a mother. Somebody else is renting the car. And we're working with our legislative delegation, with Mike and and Claire and the legislative delegation, because we need some help legislatively in being able to make it more difficult to just use rental cars as a shield from being accountable. So one of the pieces of legislation we're asking for is to determine that if someone is driving a rental car and they're not listed on the rental agreement, that that would constitute unauthorized use of a motor vehicle. If the driver's not listed on the rental agreement, because the drivers committing the crimes are rarely listed on the rental agreement. In that case, if we stop someone and they're not listed on the rental agreement, even though it may only be a misdemeanor, they'd be breaking the law, and that would then be probable cause to search the vehicle, get the person out of the vehicle, tow the car. It would give us a tool to use to try to combat this misuse of rental cars, just as one example. And we've got a problem with the bail system. And there's some legislation pending in this session right now. I can't remember the number, but I've discussed it with our legislative delegation. Right now, when bail is set on a defendant, if the defendant feels the bail is too high, they can appeal the bail to a higher court, get a hearing to have the bail reconsidered. However, if the prosecution feels the bail is too low, they have no recourse. So the judges, if they don't want their bail decisions being reviewed,
that's my question.
Yeah, will they have more incentive to set lower bails that can't be appealed instead of higher bails that might be appealed and overturned by a higher court? So the piece of legislation that's pending would basically just give equity in bail that would say that if either the prosecution or the defendant does not think the bail was set properly, they can appeal that decision. So the prosecutor can have the same right as the defendant to appeal the judge's decision on bail. Because another common thing that we see constantly with these is every time we do get someone, it's most common that they've got two or three open cases already pending against them. We had a case recently after a pretty lengthy investigation, armed home invasion. Three people, armed home invasion. Put a gun to people's heads, threatening to kill them. After a investigation that took several weeks, arrests were made, good investigation, good arrests, got them, all three out on bail the next day. So, you know, that gets discouraging, that we're spending all these resources and we can't get them off the street. So there are no easy answers, but what I can tell you is to the extent that we can, we're using all the resources we possibly can to target high-risk individuals, targets of mutual interest that we know are involved with illegal guns and illegal drugs. And again, we need the help and support of the community to get these people out of our city. Drug overdoses, while we're on good news. Yesterday, in the city of Brockton, 16 drug overdoses we responded to. 16 drug overdoses in one day. It's mind-boggling. On average, we respond to about three per day, which I think is mind-boggling. We're doing about 100 Narcan saves a month. But yesterday, 16 in one day. Today it was six when I was on my way over here today. A couple on one of the commuter rail trains this evening. At one of the Brockton stops. So, you know, we also are fighting against an opiate addiction crisis. And that's a community problem too, because everybody pays a price. Tonight here in the neighborhood, I don't know if you mentioned this before I got here, Officer Gailey, there's been a rash of some car break-ins right in this area, right around here. So tonight we do have a couple officers out in the neighborhood, and they do have a couple people of interest looking to try to arrest the person who's breaking into cars. Car break-ins, got to catch them doing it. In most cases, to be able to make a good arrest or have them on videotape, one or the other.
But the reason I mention that is that we know that 80 or 90% of the property crime being committed in the city is being committed by people who are stealing to support a drug habit. Breaking into cars, shoplifting, breaking into houses, whatever it may be. So sometime within the next month or so, we are going to roll out a Gloucester type of plan here in Brockton, where we have a very proactive outreach effort to try to connect people to services, so that if someone reaches that moment, they say, you know what, I think I'm ready to get out of the game and try to get myself some help, that we have a way to get them into treatment and support them and help them. We showed a movie a couple of nights ago over at the War Memorial Building called If Only. Several of you were there. And it was an awareness film talking about the dangers of prescription painkiller abuse, prescription drug abuse, particularly by teenagers. And at that event, I think we had 4 or 5 police officers there as part of that event. And those police officers are not there because we won't arrest anyone for drug possession. They're there because we all realize that the answer is not always to put someone in a police cruiser, it's to get them into the back of an ambulance and get them into treatment and help them solve the underlying problem and give them some support. So we're committed to doing that. Now, we're also committed to arresting drug dealers. So the rule of thumb we use is the same rule of thumb as the Good Samaritan law: weight and warrants. If you're carrying a substantial quantity of drugs that are packaged for resale, we're going to put you in jail. If you have an outstanding warrant, we don't have any choice. We have to lock you up. But we're not interested in arresting people for simple possession. And with this plan, we're going to make it as easy as we can for someone to reach out and say, help me, and be ready and prepared to immediately get them help and not arrest them. So we've got to tackle that. Property tax bills. I'll be brief because honestly, it requires a fairly lengthy explanation to answer all the questions. But I do support the idea of Tom and Councilor Farwell holding the tax abatement workshop. If you have questions about your bill, I encourage you to be there. We will have some multilingual people from my staff there to provide translation for people who need it or ask for it. But in essence, there are a number of factors. The budget that I submitted this year to the council went up 2.1%. It was a 2.1% increase in the budget. And on a $3,000 tax bill a year, that would be about a $60 increase or $5 a month. On a $3,500 bill, it'd be about a $70 increase or about $6 a month. That's the average spread across all the bills. And the decision I had to make at the time in submitting that budget was $5 or $6 a month for the average tax bill to avoid major teacher layoffs, including the closure of at least one and possibly two schools, firefighter layoffs that would have included the closing of a fire station, possibly turning out half the street lights, the repercussions of covering an entire $6.6 million deficit with just cuts would have been devastating. Now, in terms of when, no, you got to let me just give the explanation because we're going to do the whole seminar for the bills. And we'll answer all the questions. There are a lot of variables. That's the average for each person's bill. But there are a lot of variables involved into what determines your bill, and I think there's a lot of misunderstanding. The first one is that when the council sets the tax rate, that divides how much of that money will be paid by residential, how much will be paid by commercial. And there's been a lot of pressure for us to try to get the commercial tax rate down because it's higher than everyone else's. So this year, the way the factor was set, the increase was directed to the residential side of the tax bill instead of the commercial. Doesn't mean that'll be that way again next year, but that's the way it was done this year. So now residences are paying higher than just the average share. Secondly, there's some good news here. The tax bill is also based upon the value of your home. And for the first time in 10 years, houses are going up in Brockton. They started going up last year. There was a small increase last year, but there was a significant increase in the average value of a home in Brockton this year. And that's borne out by the statistics, and that's good news, because we've been through years of people going underwater on their houses, buying a house and then having it go down in value and owe more in mortgage than what the house is worth. A lot of people were really hurt when the housing market crashed. And now we've got this city turned around and people are buying houses here again, and the house values were not just going up a little bit the past year, they're going up a lot, which means that's tens of thousands of dollars of equity being restored to your value in your home. But it also means that the valuation, which is multiplied by the rate, is going to cause the tax to be higher. And then I think the third variable that's very misunderstood by a lot of people looking at the bills, and it's extremely confusing, and as Councilor Rodriguez said, this process was set a long, long time ago. But when the council sets the rate, it is already halfway through the tax year. The tax year is not January 1st to December 31st. People are getting these bills at the beginning of January, and they feel as though this is the first bill of the year, and that whatever that increase is times four. So if they see a $100 increase on a quarterly bill, they're assuming that their taxes went up $400 per year. But that's not true. The bill that comes out in January, the tax year, goes from July 1st to June 30th, the fiscal year, just like the city's budget. So the tax bill that just came out in January is the third of four quarterly bills. You've already had two quarterly bills for this tax year that were not impacted by the new tax rate. So now what happens, whatever the tax increase is for this year, the tax increase for the entire year is put on to just the final two quarterly bills of the year. And you're right, there's nothing that easily explains that when you open the bill. If you don't understand how the system works, I see why people just assume. I didn't say it was fair or equitable, I just said that's how it's done. And when I asked why,
That's why we lose
the answer the regulators tell me is that because in the budget year they want the city council to have a chance to be halfway through the year, because when we do that budget, when we submit the budget and pass the budget for July 1st, there are a lot of assumptions in there, projections. We're projecting how much money we think we're going to collect. We're projecting how much money we think we're going to spend. So by waiting until the end of the second quarter, it gives the council a chance to look back over half of the year to make sure that the projections and the assumptions that were made 6 months ago when the budget was approved are holding true. And if something unanticipated had come up in either direction, the council would have an opportunity to make a correction before the final rate was set for the year. I know that's a kind of a convoluted explanation, but it's the best one I've got. This system was around long before I was. But I think the really important thing to understand is that your January bill and your April bill, whatever that increase is, the real increase in the tax is only half of that amount, because two quarters have already gone by that there was no increase on. Now the increase has been determined, and now there's only two bills left, so a full year's worth of increase is piled on to only half a year's worth of bills. So if your bill was up $200, it means that the increase is really only $100, and that when the July 1st bill comes and we start a new tax year, your increase will only be $100. But it's $200 right now, because $100 a quarter would be $400 for the year, but they've got to squeeze it into just the two remaining bills. So that means they're putting $200 and $200, so it adds up to the $400 for the year. When July 1st comes, the increase of $100 a quarter is what it will really be. So there is an unfair aspect to it, that it's not in the year of the increase, it's not spread out evenly over the whole year. For the first half of the year, you don't get any change, and then the whole thing is piled on the last two bills. But I do find almost every person I've spoken to when they show me the bill is just assuming that whatever that increase is, they're taking that times four, and they think that's how much their bill went up for the year, but it's that amount times two. That's what was added to the remaining two bills. So I hope that helps a little. It's kind of a real basic explanation. But if you want help, one of the big factors, if you had a higher than average increase, if you look at your valuation of your house versus the valuation last year, you're probably going to see that it jumped up. House values did go up. But, you know, they're assessing 20,000 houses. They're not all going to be exactly right. It's an automated program that looks at all the information that they've got on file. They only look at so many houses each year. So something that's going to be done differently this year that it has not been done in the past is that anyone who files for an abatement, you have an opportunity right now before the end of January, that if you feel that the value that they assign to your house is higher than what your house is really worth, then you can file an abatement with the assessor, and that will cause the assessor to check your specific house and reevaluate it to consider to see if a mistake may have been made. And in this case now, with our new assessor, he has made a pledge that on every single abatement, they will physically, we have three assessors that work for the assessor's department, that one of the three assessors will actually go out and physically look at the house and compare it to the information, compare it to the comps, and if they show that the increase was too high, that the house is not worth what it was assessed at, then they will adjust the bill. Now, doesn't mean they automatically will do that, but it means that you'll get a fair reevaluation of the value of your property to see if that assessed value is correct or not. If you're in doubt at all, you should apply for the abatement. There's no downside. They won't raise your bill this year. So if you think it's too high, you should file for the abatement. That means going into the assessor's office at City Hall, or the form is available online. If you go into the virtual City Hall on the city website, go into assessors, you can click on, get a PDF version of the form and print it out if you want to save the trip into the assessor's office. If you want to ask some questions, by all means, go into the assessor's office. Now, it gets a little tricky. The assessor's office, by law, can answer general questions about how the tax was calculated, how your valuation was calculated. They cannot assist you in filling out the form. And if you think about it, the reason why the state doesn't allow them to assist you is because they're the ones that are going to make the decision on it afterwards. So they can't be the one helping apply for it and the one making the decision afterwards. And however, Councilors Farwell and Monahan will have the workshop going next week. They'll have forms available there. You can go to that workshop, and at that workshop, you will be able to get assistance if you want to file for an abatement for your property. Some people decide to pursue it. Some, when they look at the value and realize that maybe that value is correct. But it does mean when you file for the abatement, they're going to come out and look at the house. That does mean you've got to let them into your house. They're going to make an appointment, and someone's got to be home to let them in so they can see your house. So I hope that's some help on the taxes. Yeah, Raymond.
The major, one of the part that I most concerned in this matter, not as much as doing the assessment from the, is the mortgage. The mortgagers right now are basing you, what you have put on the increase, in a tie of doubling in charges. Yeah. And that's why the city doesn't do something against them for what they're doing.
Right, so I can't speak for how a specific bank does their policies. I'm not the bank, I'm the mayor. What I can tell you how it's supposed to work. So what he's referring to is most people, if they have a mortgage on their house, pay their taxes through an escrow account, and it's spread out, it's included in the mortgage payment, spread out over the year. So in most cases, that will be an advantage because whatever the increase is in tax in these final two quarters, when they recalculate the escrow, they'll recalculate that escrow payment spread out over 12 months. Where sometimes people get really into trouble on the escrow is if they don't pay their water and sewer bill. Because after the water and sewer bill goes past due for a certain length of time, it's then leaned onto the real estate tax bill. And once the lien goes against the real estate tax bill, the bank is going to pay it, and it's going to cause a problem. We saw people really get into some trouble with those, and so you have to be careful.
Do you guys want to lose the house because of the way do you guys put a higher tax? We're going to lose the house in Brockton.
The value.
The two family, over $4,000.
Yeah. So as I've had a chance to start looking at a few since the bills came out.
Yeah, because this is too high.
Right.
For us.
I understand.
You know what to do.
It appears from the few that I've started to look at that the 2 and 3 family houses were some of the ones that really took a big jump up in value this year.
We're gonna lose it.
I'm not the assessor, but the reason is that the sales prices, everything is based, and at the workshop, they'll explain to you how a property is valued. But how the assessor does it is the assessor identifies 3 properties in your neighborhood that sold in the past year that are similar to yours. And they compare those 3 recent sales to the amenities of your house in terms of square footage, bedrooms, etc. Obviously, a 3-family house with 3 3-bedroom apartments is worth more money than a 3-family house with 3 2-bedroom apartments.
You know, in 2002, my neighbor sell a house in 3,020,000. I pay tax $2,000 on the house. My house valued 2,040. Now I pay $4,000.
Right, so if the value, if houses selling in the neighborhood, if the sales prices are going up, that's going to cause your value. But again, we can't. So with your concerns with your individual bill, what I would suggest is that you come to the abatement workshop. If you feel that the assessor has overvalued your property, then you put in for the abatement to have it reconsidered. I understand how difficult it is for people to pay taxes. The topic that was discussed a little bit earlier, as we had various communities in the city represented up here, was around communication with the various communities in the city. So I just wanted to show a couple quick examples that the city is proactively trying to cooperate in getting information out in various languages. So something else that's very misunderstood all the time, every year, is the winter parking ban. If you live on a street that's subject to the winter parking ban. So what we've done this year is we put out the informational flyer in 4 languages on the winter parking ban. So this is in an effort to try to help people who may not speak English as their first language to get an explanation as to where they can park during a snow emergency, and also what streets are subject to the winter parking ban. We also came out this year with a Brockton business guide for small business owners or people that are thinking about starting a business. And this is to help a business owner or a prospective business owner navigate their way through city government. And we're in the process of having these all translated also. So these are available at City Hall. They're also available online on the city's website. But now this is the exact same small business guide, Brockton business guide in Spanish. So we've come out with the Spanish language version, and we're in the process of having both Cape Verdean Creole and Haitian Creole also translated. So for certain types of really important information that we need to get out to the community, we are making an effort to get it out in multiple languages so that hopefully people won't have misunderstandings. Okay? All right. I think I covered everything you wanted me to talk about. Give it back to Councilor Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. And now we're going to bring up the city planner with some really good news about the downtown development, a new plan that's come to the city now, is City Planner Rob May.
Councilor, I want to thank you for...
Hello, excuse me, can we keep it down, please?
...allowing me to speak after we've talked about taxes. Here with this issue. Many of you may know that we've been working on a downtown action strategy for the last 6-8 months now. Mass Development, the financing, development financial arm of the city, of the state, has designated us as a Transformative Development Initiative District, TDI for short, and they've been working with us, matching with some funds to allow us to create a downtown strategy that really synthesizes some of the great planning work that's come before us into an actionable document that assigns tasks for people in City Hall and for community groups to work with, and it's really been a great planning process. We've had a large and growing list of community leaders and groups. I see Lynn taking a photograph over here. So we've had the Frederick Douglass Neighborhood Association. We've had the two ward councilors, Monahan and now Councilor Beauregard involved, the Parking Authority, Shirley Isaac and the Beautification Committee. A lot of the at-large councilors have been involved in the process. The Haitian community, the Cape Verdean community, everybody's been invited to this table to participate in this downtown strategy. The second phase of this planning process is going to be starting hopefully in February, where we're going to submit these two plans, the action strategy and an urban revitalization plan, to City Council for their approval. Urban revitalization plan is prepared under the Massachusetts General Laws 121B. It provides extra authority and powers to the Brockton Redevelopment Authority to actually implement the plan that we've produced. At the same time, we hope to have what's called a District Improvement Financing Plan, DIF for short, that's going to then pay for the improvements that we want to make. So we have a vision with a roadmap, we have the tools and the authority to do it, and then we have a mechanism to finance the acquisitions and development downtown. Now, we've been working with a large section of our downtown area, and I can play Vanna. So everything from White Street and on the south up north to Elliott, mostly along Main Street, Montello, and Warren Ave. But there's been a large concentration of work in the downtown area right around the MBTA train station, the commuter rail station. What we would like to see over the next couple of years is a plan that is going to allow us to build off of the work that Trinity Financial has done and their wonderful development of the enterprise block, work with some really great buildings, existing buildings downtown, getting them rehabilitated, but also then working with the Parking Authority, getting a parking garage constructed downtown that will then open up some of the surface lots that we have for redevelopment. Right now we have a lot of surface lots that don't park people, but they don't generate a lot of tax revenue. God knows this city needs tax revenue. So we have a development plan. If you if you're looking at this over the next 10 years, this is the Trinity project, and this is W.B. Mason. We allow for Trinity's phase two, and then development along Montello, where the Dunkin' Donuts and the old D'Angelo's and the Avon car used car lot are. We think that that's the first step for us, is to work with a developer to acquire those properties. That will allow us then to move the surface parking that is currently at Trinity's site across the street and allow Trinity to build their phase two, which we hope to see in 2017. Make a note, 2017, they're pushing Matt. So they have to arrange their financing, but that's a plan that has been approved by the planning board, so it's ready to go. We are working with a couple of developers who are interested in the old furniture building. Sometimes it's called the Algrim building because Algrim Insurance was there, but it was actually started, that's a factory. It was a shoe factory, beautiful as it is. And then there's a couple other buildings downtown that we want to see rehabilitated. So we're working with the state on historic tax credits. We've created, and with the help of city council, we've created a housing development incentive zone downtown that provides state tax credits for market rate housing downtown. Market rate. So this is, you know, something that a lot of cities can't do. It's only available to gateway cities. And so we're layering as many state and federal incentives on the district right now so that people can, you know, pick and choose what fits best for them to see the redevelopment of their property. But what we would like to see are more people living downtown, more mixed income, you know, downtown, mixed use. We'd like to see more restaurants, more retail, people walking. Back in the old neighborhood, you used to walk from place to place. And I know it's late in the evening, so I'll wrap up quickly, but as Councilor Monahan mentioned, we received a grant from the state yesterday, a $50,000 planning grant. It's not Powerball, but it was a nice, you know, nice step. Thank you, Uncle Charles. What we would like to do, and Cindy, can I get you to hold that up, play Vanna for a second? You might remember, if you spend any time downtown, High Street, for you old-timers, Frederick Douglass for us newcomers, there is a city-owned property. It's right around the corner from the old Kresge department store, and we think it would make a great location for what we're calling a restaurant incubator. And like most communities that have great immigrant backgrounds, whether you're Irish or Swedish, or Lithuanian, or Cape Verdean, Portuguese, Lebanese, Haitian. We all have great family recipes and traditions, and we all think deep in our heart that we could be really great restaurateurs, because there's something special about, you know, the way my family cooked or the way that my culture cooked. And what the incubator would do would be to divide that building up into very small little restaurants, and we would provide technical assistance. We'd work with a consultant that would help the entrepreneurs understand what it's like to run a restaurant, how to price out a menu, work with the cooks and the chefs to get their menus and their recipes just right, and to prove that they could do, you know, the restaurant business. At the end of a year, you're more likely to get financing from a bank. Then, you know, it's almost impossible to finance a restaurant if you don't have at least a year's worth of experience. How do you get a year's worth of experience? Go to an incubator like this. So it will all be fitted out, is the concept. It'll have all the hoods and the ventilation systems and the refrigeration and all the kitchen equipment, everything like that. What comes in, an entrepreneur comes in, small little space, paint it to whatever your concept is. You decorate it just a little bit, but it takes a lot of the risk out of the process and adds a lot of value. And then once you get that kind of experience, we'll hope you'll grow, and we hope you grow into another space in downtown. So it could be a really interesting project, and this feasibility study will show us that it can be done, and then how do we finance it? And so we'll be looking at various foundations and government programs to help us do these kinds of things. Because kitchen work, hospitality industry, it's very forgiving, especially for, you know, young juveniles who run afoul of the law periodically. This is a great opportunity to build skills and get back into the workforce. It's also a great opportunity for people to build on their culture and create new employment opportunities for themselves and their relatives. So I, you know, thank you for inviting me to your meeting. And I can't solve your tax bill, but he will certainly help you. Oh, I'm sorry. We are on Facebook. Rob May on Facebook, six simple letters, but we've created pages for these projects, and we constantly post new information about what's going on. We hope to have more pages as the planning department programs expand. When we start planning in Campello, when we start planning in other neighborhoods, we'll be creating new pages to let people know, because we want to be open and transparent to everybody. We want everybody to participate in these meetings and to have good communication. So thank you very much for having me out here, and I hope that you all participate in projects in the future. Did you have a question?
I want to know what's going on with the downtown college project.
I do too.
I came in.
You came in late.
So I'm just trying to see
not
that.
A problem. When the new governor came in, he had to make some very tough budget choices, and so he stopped or put a hold on a good six or seven college expansion programs, new buildings on college campuses all over the state, and so we're reevaluating those. The mayor and I and the legislative delegation, we're working on Plan B. We think that it is a valuable program. We want to continue working on it downtown. It's really important when we look at the workforce situation, the residents downtown, how important it is to work on high school degree completion, certificates, credentialing to get people into the workforce, and eventually working on baccalaureate and post-baccalaureate degrees. So it is a high priority of the administration, and we're continuing to work with our legislative delegation and with the governor to get this into the next round of funding.
So basically that area around that college, no projects are going to take effect until that's done? So you're just going to keep everything on hold until it's...
We have a whole series of projects that we're working on downtown. We're not just waiting for the Higher Education Center. And so that's, you know, part of this.
The reason why I ask is because I'm going on 8 years now. Tony Rodriguez, by the way, trying to move my project forward. Mine was brought up before, way before this college was, and I'm waiting for that to be done. The city won't move on my project.
Well, we can talk about that offline then.
Probably with tax
thank
increase,
you.
Maybe get there.
All right, thank you very much, Tom.
Okay, thanks a lot. All right, just one more little thing. Amy Corum from the Brighton Symphony Orchestra just wanted to promote the children's concert she's doing, producing. Get this out right there.
Hey, don't forget Monday, we have a Martin Luther King event that Cindy has signed, and everybody's invited with some free food and fun from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
And don't forget, on Sunday, we're having a tribute for Mrs. Dubois. It's at the Arnon. From 6 o'clock to 8, please. Anyone come and pay tribute to her. Also, the Ezra Gallery is open Tuesday, Thursday,
all right,
Friday,
we got somebody up here speaking.
Saturday.
There you go. Somebody at the mic.
I'm Amy Corum, and I'm a lifelong Brocktonian. I was born here, and I started playing piano when I was 3 because my mother was a piano teacher, and I gave my first public recital at 8 at the Y downtown in Brockton, and my dad was a poultry dealer on Bay Street. Does anybody remember Bay Street, which was where the main post office is now in Brockton? But if I could be with my dad at the chicken company, I didn't have to practice, so I was a very happy kid. So when I was 10, I played with the Brockton Symphony a piece called Carnival of the Animals, and I decided this year that 50 years later, I was going to perform that piece again with the symphony. Now I'm on the board of the Brockton Symphony, so I sort of made my own gig. And I am producing a concert on March 6th, and I'm going to be playing that. And I also included the Brockton High School Band is going to be playing pieces from Mary Poppins, because it's the 50th anniversary of Mary Poppins, and the Plouffe School will be performing, and the South Middle School Jazz Choir is going to be performing also, Music of Sound of Music, which is also 50 years since the release. So I'm calling this the 50th anniversary children's concert, and what I wanted to do was bring back the concept of a children's concert like I did when I was 10 years old, and we're charging just $5 for children to come in and 10 for adults, because I want every kid in Brockton to be able to come to a children's concert and bring everybody together, sort of like what we're talking about. And that's what I can do. I'm a musician, so in my way, I'm trying to get back to Brockton. I never left Brockton. My two children went through all the schools of Brockton, and they both have master's degrees, and I'm proud of Brockton, and I have no problem telling everybody about that wherever I go. So I hope on March 6th you'll come on over to the high school. I brought my idea down to the superintendent, and she loved the idea so much that she gave me the high school and custodian and police, and she said, go for it, and I hope to fill the Brockton High School with 1,500 kids to this concert. And I, just to make it a little flashy, I rented the Liberace rhinestone piano to play on, so it's going to be very cool. And I also discussed with the art director in Brockton to have kids draw pictures of these animals that I listed in my piece. So we're going to have it projected on a 20-foot screen in the back of the stage while we play the music. So it will be a very big event on March 6th, and I hope you'll all come. So
thanks, Amy. All right, and that's about it. Thanks a lot for coming. We'll see you in a couple of months. Thanks.